Hi, I'm Joshua Hassel.
And I'm Brigitte Schluger, and this is The Object of My Desire, a program about people, passion, and art.
We're here today at the Metro Center for the Visual Arts, where gallery director Sally Parachot has put together an exciting show of contemporary Western art.
The West as Subject looks at the West as an inexhaustible supply of images and concepts. The works here are less traditional than we're used to when we talk about Western art, but they have an undeniable energetic power.
Brigitte and I are standing here in front of the vintage hand-colored photographs of artist Bob Wade.
Bob Wade has really created a romantic illusion of the cowboy myth.
In today's show, we'll be looking at more of the pieces in the West as Subject. We'll also take you to a new exhibition space, the Center for Visual Awareness.
Our resident art critic, Michael Paglia, will review the sculptures of Louise Bourgeois at the Ginny Williams Family Foundation. And Diane Vanderlip from the Denver Art Museum will chat with artist Donald Lipsky about his central cello case.
We also have the premiere of Alan Frame Hill's new short film, When Push Comes to Shove.
And in Boulder, Kyle Balding caught up with photographer Mark Sink to find out about his most recent project.
When 100 years ago, a visionary named James Lawrence Breese formed a salon he called 1001 Nights. This turn-of-the-century group of mischievous partiers broke new ground in the world of photography. They made photography an art form. Tonight, James L. Breese's great-grandson, Mark Sink, has brought together the members of his salon, the Denver Salon, to carry on the vision of his great-grandfather.
I can't talk about how the formation of the Denver Salon started without the whole inspiration of starting to learn that my great-grandfather was a photographer in the turn of the century. In starting to research the turn of the century photographers, that there were some groups of photographers, the pictorialists in particular, that were photographers that were striding to break away from commercial photography. You can look at these photographs, and they're soft. In many cases, they're all using very interesting techniques. Again, this is just a true artistic use of photography. Very manipulated negatives. They would paint on them. They would scratch and etch on the negatives. It's a tradition, again, just to break away from the standard clear photographic techniques of the day. Interviews, what we want to talk about is the parallel between my great-grandfather, who was James L. Breese. He was a notorious, illustrious, kind of high society man in New York in the turn of the century. He put together a group of fine art photographers called the Carbonites, and they would meet at 12 o'clock at night and pose and do pictures and dress up and red velvet swing and girls popping out of pies, and it was a mixture of sort of lavacious intrigue with serious study of passing chemical theories and art ideas. At this turn of the century, I'm putting together a group of photographers that's very similar to this. Most of the people of this group, which we've called the Denver Salon, has very many parallels to this. It's a large number of the group are people who first went through art school and then started to apply photography as just a tool of their producing artwork.
This guy our newest member of the group. He does the work of night work in Denver. He's the Ajay of Denver. He's been photographing Denver for the last 10 years, all of its development. He has a flip book of the Montgomery Ward's building falling down. Flip through a genius work. We got to get some close-ups.
Center approached us with great enthusiasm and excitement. I planned and formed with the whole group to take over the whole space and how we would create this ambience of what I was pushing towards, the recreation of this turn of the century salon in this setting, and that involved all the elements that was going on in 1894 of the salon walls. They had Evelyn Nesbitt in the red velvet swing. We had the red velvet swing and the drapery, and having an interior designer work on wrapping things and bows and ribbons and placing it just so it gives a whole atmospheric effect at that time, which was highly successful. Of this group of the Denver Salon is dream come true for me. It's producing people's friends who I greatly admire and have always admired their work, and it's a chance to put them up on the stage along with myself. And most of all, where the dream come true is having the girl in the red velvet swing pulling my great-grandfather in on this. It's always been a separate. It's been me, my work, or my great-grandfather's work of trying to get this dead relative up and knowing how, or is it my work? It's very confusing for people, and this is the first time I'm bringing them both together, and it's really working as a viable impact of drawing from the ideals and the manifesto of them at the turn of the century and the direct parallels to us with social, politically, artistically, with our parallels of 1994, the exact same thing that it pulls together is one complete impact that is so exciting. It's a dream come true. It's my dream. I'm very excited. And we have a lot more to come.
Ginny Williams is a patron with a passion for the arts. It's in her blood. Ginny established the Ginny Williams Family Foundation as a nonprofit with the intent to bring world-renowned artists to the Rocky Mountain West and to encourage and support regional art. The foundation sets a standard of excellence without commercial limitations. This is Ginny's gift to Denver. Next, our resident art critic, Michael Paglia, will review the show of Louise Bourgeois at the foundation.
Contemporary art is most often seen as something meant for those who think young. That's why it's interesting, if a little strange, to find that an 80-something artist is at the forefront of contemporary art in the 90s. But such is the case with Louise Bourgeois. The earliest works in this fine show, the second time Ginny Williams has presented Bourgeois, are paintings from the 1940s. In these pieces, Bourgeois is already dealing with the approach that will inform her work for the following 50 years, surrealism. But the oldest pieces in this show, which may be said to be characteristic of Bourgeois' work, and which established her as a major artist, are the totemic sculptures of the 1950s, which recall African tribal art. Reacting to those art critics who pointed out that this work was phallic, Bourgeois began to consciously integrate feminine imagery, as is seen in a piece such as Mamelle from 1991, which is a pink rubber frieze depicting women's breasts. The same issues doubtless inform Nature Study, a bronze from 1984. The masculine Needle 3 incorporates content inspired by feminist critiques of sex and gender. This sculpture literally asserts a powerful threat of assault. Yet its feminine companion, Fouad, in many ways essentially the same sculpture, is embracing as opposed to assertive. One of the most obvious for its political content, though all are easy to read, is Le Defi 3. Signifiers for women, blown glass floats, canning jars, mirrors, and flower frogs, are constrained by signifiers for male oppression, the metal shelves on which the objects sit, and the lighted glass male head. Though Louise Bourgeois has been well known for decades, it's only in the last few years that she's become one of the most famous artists in the world. And based on exhibits like this one, it's easy to see why. This is Michael Paglia for Critical View on The Object of My Desire.
It's sometimes hard to understand what is happening in modern art. When we use the term avant-garde, it means in advance of. In this next piece, filmed for two monitors by Amy Knox of Wild Wolf Productions, Denver Art Museum curator Diane Vanderlip chats with Donald Lipsky about the cello case that he has filled with candles. Diane and Donald make the avant-garde a lot more user-friendly.
The museum is doing this exhibition in honor of its centennial year, its 100th birthday. And what we want to do for this exhibition is show people what a museum is really all about. The fact that from the beginning of time, these things that these people make are made by artists. You know, it's all part of a living continuum. So somewhere along the line, somebody got the idea of, well, you know, you buy something like a Donald Lipsky, and you have something in the museum like a Degas, and a lot of the people who come into the museum are going to say, God, why would anybody buy a harp case full of candles? Why don't they only buy these masterpieces like Degas? But I'm afraid people come to museums with certain assumptions already of what is art and what is not art. And if they could come to the Donald Lipsky harp case with the same kind of assumptions they bring to the Degas examining the dance, I think their experience would be much more rich, because they would make the assumption, right, this is art, and let me consider it in that context. How could you use a harp case as art, or what makes that art?
I guess it's art just because I make the decision that it's art. I, as the artist, thinking about Degas, was Degas around the time that photography was starting to be common?
Yes.
See, because you look at his things and they're like a snapshot. They're not classically composed like The Last Supper.
Yes.
Or something like that. And maybe the casualness of that was why people said, well, this isn't art.
Of course, in Degas' own time, everybody thought that he was, you know, totally
a wacko. Yeah.
How come he became an artist?
I I think it's a genetic defect.
The surprise that happens when your case gets open. I kind of want to know what you had in mind when you created this piece.
It's hard to give you a straight answer because I don't know exactly what was in my mind. When I've shown this piece, I've shown it so that when you first walk into the room, you see the back of the harp case, and you go around it, and then you see the candles and have the surprise. In a sense, it's the same surprise that you would have opening the case.
That's very interesting, especially since we're comparing it to Degas, because Degas kind of always shows you the back, and you almost anticipate what the surprise, not always, Degas often shows you the back of the situation, and you can imagine what the surprise would be in front. Let's talk about sex.
Okay.
Okay? Okay. These candles have such an extraordinary sensuous appeal, and I think of Degas and the way that he used women. Degas used women like furniture. You use candles like women, you know? You, on the other hand, create a kind of sensuality with your props that is absolutely embarrassing.
Candles, because they're long and thin and just about the right size, are so obviously male that when I saw these candles, and realized that looking at them dead on, they looked like a nipple or like a breast, and that these phallic things could become female, that got me real excited.
So to speak.
So to speak, yeah.
Yours is just so full of metaphors, and...
Well, you know, looking at this, I was thinking about a metaphor that might be common to both of these. In the Degas, drawing, there are these young girls who are being watched over or tutored or something by this old woman. And you just know, if you stop to think about it, that this old woman at one time was one of those young girls.
Oh, yeah.
Now, a candle also is about the passage of time, and and because of that, it's about life and death. You light a candle, it burns down, and it's gone, and there's nothing left. It's always interesting to me to hear what other people, what's evoked to them when they look at the piece, because usually it makes perfect sense to me, even though I wasn't thinking about it. Mm-hmm. You know, and to me, that's personally a mark of success.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Picasso said, "Anything anybody sees in my art is there." So, how did the Denver Museum decide to buy this piece?
We first saw this piece when we visited you in your studio, and I knew that it was expressing something important in the sense that it was making me very anxious and very nervous. That seems to be, my hairs were kind of standing up on end.
So, is your hope that the whole museum or museums in general be filled with things that are going to affect people that way?
It seems to me that that's the bottom line of what a museum ought to be about, that somehow people ought to be able to come in and have almost a visceral experience,
yeah.
An experience that isn't like looking at a sunset, that isn't like looking at a play, that isn't like any other experience except looking at an object that an artist made and somehow being touched by it.
When you're having your bicentennial, maybe people will be coming in and looking at this 200-year-old harp case.
That's exactly the idea of why we collect these objects throughout time.
Next up, we have the premiere of filmmaker Alan Framehill's new short, When Push Comes to Shove. It features the two significant guys, performance artist Ray Shalganoff and Hugh Graham. And in the background, you may recognize some of Denver's better-known landmarks.
Thank you.
Popular vernacular, I think that's what you might call whack.
That was pretty wacky.
Alan Frame Hill told me that this is the first in the series using the two significant guys.
Well, I know I'm looking forward to seeing the next installment.
Brigetta and I are here at the Metro State Center for the Visual Arts, standing in front of this large painting by Carlos Fresquez.
Carlos is very proud of his Hispanic American heritage. This large painting is a bright, vibrant portrait of the vaquero, the Mexican cowboy, as he charges across the western landscape.
Carlos has created this altar as a homage to his grandfather. It's entitled Para Mi Abuelo Fernando Vesquez.
It is custom for family and friends to add their own personal mementos to this living memorial.
The modern West has a unique and rugged heritage that is reflected in the artworks of Tracy and Sushi Felix, this husband and wife, who face the struggle to combine the elements of Western traditions and modern painting techniques. Tracy Felix joins fantasy to reality. When depicting mountains, he shares the same sense of awe and excitement as the early 19th century Western landscape painters. His wife Sushi Felix geometric abstracts are inspired more by the early 20th century painters of the Southwest. In this painting entitled Bull Rider, Sushi has captured the essence, the energy, and the movement of a cowboy riding a bull. Her painting technique emulates the feel of a Native American sand painting.
For our final segment entitled Street Level, Gary Sweeney visits Russian artist Vyacheslav Kalinin at Denver Salon Gallery and also takes us to Jim Presnu Gallery, the Center for Visual Awareness. Thanks for watching. We hope to see you again next time on The Object of My Desire.
Hi, I'm Gary Sweeney, and we're standing outside in the freezing cold in front of the Sloan Gallery in the lower downtown historic district of Denver, Colorado. And we're about to go in and see an exhibition of the famous Russian painter Vyacheslav Kalinin. So come with us.
This is wonderful.
Yes.
Well, these are very, very rich paintings, rich in color, rich in history, rich in the arts.
Thank you.
Mary, does this red remind you of like an opening of Pirate?
Me too, right?
Standing here with Piccolo, noted art critic, and we're looking at the paintings of famous Russian painter Vyacheslav Kalinin, and I was wondering, did you see this as an extension of the renowned political and social satire so prevalent in early 20th century Russian art, or do you see this as an immediate and direct reaction to that sort of social satire? Okay. Thank you.
polished piece of show.
Pretty whack.
Really whack.
Oh, excuse me. That was really whack.
Thank you, ma'am.